Good morning, friends from Ballatin UMC. We are semi-live. I'm recording this, and so you can enjoy it whenever you want to. As I stepped out of the parsonage this morning, it was so nice to see the sun and just breathe in the fresh air. I'm going to get out for a walk a little bit later today, and I hope you are too. And so again, welcome to worship today. Last night, I had my microphone on. Those of you who joined for the communion, thank you for that. I had my microphone on thinking that the volume would probably be better. But here in an empty sanctuary, the echo is so bad that it wasn't great. And so I'm going to leave that off today, and we're just going to see how all of this goes. Okay? We are in Mark's Gospel, chapter 13 today. If you have your Bible, you can follow along with that, and if you do not have your Bible, don't sweat it, okay? Kind of a tough passage. When I first opened our narrative lectionary on Monday, that was the passage that it gave us. Keep in mind, it's Holy Week here in our text, and Jesus is heading to the cross, and he's got a limited time with his disciples about what he wants to tell them. And so this is part of that, as I'll get into in our message for today. Keep in mind, this passage is not meant to scare us. It really comes to life right now with what we are dealing with, but it is not meant to scare us. It is just meant to prepare us. And it is right here in our biblical text. And so to not unpack it, to not preach it, I think would be kind of a jab at Jesus, all right? And so I prayed about it and decided, yeah, we're going to go there. We're going to unpack it. And so I'm going to do that to the best of my ability. But let me share these words with you from Mark's Gospel, chapter 13. Jesus foretells the future. As Jesus was leaving the temple that day, one of his disciples said, "Teacher, look at these magnificent buildings. Look at all the impressive stones in the walls." Jesus replied, "Yes, look at these great buildings, but they will be completely demolished. Not one stone will be left on top of the other." Later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives across the valley from the temple, and Peter, James, and John, and Andrew came to him privately and asked him, "Tell us, when will all of this happen? What sign will show us that these things are about to be fulfilled?" Jesus replied, "Don't let anyone mislead you, for many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am the Messiah.' They will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in many parts of the world, as well as famines. But this is the only thing, the first part of the birth pains, with more to come." Scooting over to verse 24. "At that time, after the anguish of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will give no light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will also be shaken. Then everyone will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with great power and glory, and he will send out his angels to gather his chosen ones from all over the world, from the farthest ends of the earth and heaven." Now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its branches bud and its leaves begin to sprout, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see all of these things taking place, you can know that his return is very near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will not pass from the scene before all of these things take place. Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will never disappear. However, no one knows the day or the hour when these things will happen, Not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. And since you don't know when that time will come, be on guard. Stay alert. The coming of the Son of Man can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. And when he left home, he gave each of his slaves instructions about the work they were to do. And he told the gatekeeper to watch for his return. You too must keep watch, for you don't know when the master of the household will return, in the evening, at midnight, before dawn, or at daybreak. Don't let him find you sleeping when he arrives without warning. I say to you that what I say to everyone, watch for him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Shiny things and staying steady. Mark 13, 1 through 8 and 24 through 37. It all started with shiny things. As Jesus was leaving the temple that day, one of his disciples said, "Teacher, look at these magnificent buildings. Look at the impressive stones in the walls. Oh, wow. They are really shiny." Those who received an in-home worship packet from me received one of those candied ring pops to enjoy as we think about how we can get so caught up in worshiping the things of this world that tend to catch our eye. This story appears in all three of our synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Synoptic just means similar. The disciples are totally enthralled with all the bells and whistles of the temple, and it glowed when the sunlight hit just right. And before we go and give the disciples a bad rap, let's just hit that pause button, okay? And I don't know about you, but I kind of like shiny things too. As of this past Friday, the governor of Minnesota, Tim Walz, has issued a shelter-in-place statement. We, as responsible citizens, are charged with staying in, or at least social distancing as much as possible to help flatten the curve of this virus spreading more. And although some of us have to still be physically present at our jobs, many of us have been abiding, there's that word abide again, as best as we possibly can, and staying at home. Our world has certainly changed quickly in 2 weeks' time. A Monday of this week, as I sat down with my coffee and I opened our text for this week, as I usually do, our text was Mark 13, the end of the age. And I let out a deep sigh. Everybody sigh. Because it isn't exactly a passage of comfort in these times, right? And so I prayed, and I paced, and I checked Facebook, and while on Facebook, I saw many posts that referenced that God was punishing us sinners, and that God sent COVID-19 to teach us a lesson. So I sighed again, and I prayed some more. Have you been doing a lot of that too? Yeah. So here's my thoughts on COVID-19 and crowns. This God of ours is a God of love and a God of grace, as evidenced in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so, do I think that God sent COVID-19 to punish us? No, I don't. However, I think our text for today is one for us to especially rest in during this time of unsettledness. And again, it isn't meant to scare us. And let me say that again. It is not meant to scare us. It is meant to prepare us. So how have you been preparing during all of this? When we as Americans first received the news that COVID-19 was invading our lives, what was the first thing we did to prepare? Ironically, every person in every household went out to the store and bought what? Toilet paper, right? TP. Although toilet paper is a necessity of life, it really isn't. I don't know about you, but I am finding out quickly what is and isn't really a necessity to live. I like shiny things. I like to be able to have the luxury of toilet paper, and I certainly don't want to run out. I like to be able to have enough bread and milk and, Lord knows, my coffee. I like my movies and my books and my music, and I like Facebook. And I like the internet. And I am thankful for social media in helping me stay connected with all of you right now. But in all actuality, there are many people around our world that do not have these things. And in the grand scheme of the big picture, these are all just shiny things. And truth be told, sometimes they cloud my vision of the one who gives me life. So here in Mark's Gospel, chapter 13, it is early on in Holy Week, perhaps about Monday or Tuesday timeline. Jesus is already in Jerusalem. It's after Palm Sunday, where we remember that his entrance into the holy city was met with both cheers and jeers. Hosanna, King of the Jews. I'm skipping ahead, but Hosanna means save us, save us. This is the vision of king that even the disciples were envisioning. Jesus as king, but one of earthly crowns, one like Caesar. Boy, Jesus will show them Romans. He will show them when he comes into his kingdom. Remember, the disciples wanted a crown too. In all three of our synoptic gospels accounts of this story, you will find more red letters than black ones, than black letters. In John's gospels, chapters 13 through 17, John 13 through 17, is what is known as Jesus's farewell discourse. If you have what's called a red-letter Bible, take note of the red. Then take note of the black. The red is Jesus talking. They're Jesus words. The black is us. There are far more red than black, which means that Jesus is talking and we need to be listening. So picture yourself as a disciple on this day, leaving the temple with Jesus. You are one of his chosen ones. We all are, friends. You are chosen. You are chosen by God himself. You are one of Jesus' sheepies. Don't forget that, okay? And we are leaving the church building, the temple, the church building, with Jesus, and we take note of just that. The building. It's really shiny, huh? Now, I am not ungrateful. My congregation works very hard and gives very generously to upkeep our church building and the church parsonage, which I am very thankful for. They never say a word when almost 100 kids get our floor dirty or find sucker sticks under the pew cushions from the confirmation students. They are cool like that. Thank you, Ballatin Sheepies, Ballatin UMC Sheepies. Because they do understand that church is more than a building of brick and mortar, and so I certainly am not ungrateful. But this is not the first time that the church has been forced outside of their walls. And I do think we need to listen to Jesus more than we talk. Jesus was trying to teach his disciples this lesson here too. He didn't have a whole lot of time left here on earth. He was heading to the cross. And what were the disciples focused on? Earthly crowns. And it's like a game of checkers. Perhaps you're going to get your checkerboard out later as you think on these things, okay? It's like this game of checkers. King me. Remember? We say that. Ha! King me. They cried, "King me," as they jumped over each other to get their crown first. So do I think God caused COVID-19? No, I do not. Let me be clear on that. Disease happens. Because God's kingdom is not yet arrived in all of its fullness. Mark 13 tells us that it's coming, though. Through red-letter Jesus words. He gives us some signs to pay attention to. That's the key here. Be still. Stop talking. Stop playing King me and pay attention to me, the King of your life, the King of heaven and earth, who is indeed coming. We just don't know when. Even Jesus himself does not know when. There's a kind of a joke, and some of you have heard me say it about this passage, about the second coming of Jesus, that's why Jesus sits on the Father's right hand, because he doesn't know the day or the time, and so when God is ready to send him back, he just can say, "Psst, hey kid, it's time to go," you know? We're called not to worry, to not worry. He's telling us, don't be alarmed. It's going to happen as it's supposed to. And he tells us it isn't going to be a picnic. It's not going to be a picnic. But to endure and to stay centered upon him. To watch and pray. And I know that many of you have been doing that. Watch and pray. Easter will look differently. Because we are not going to be together in person. Our United Methodist Bishop, Bruce O, has mandated no in-person worship in the Dakota, Minnesota United Methodist churches until at least May 10th in order to stay protected. And I am so glad that he is our bishop. It is just wise leadership. Do I like it? No, not any more than you do, not any more than Bishop O does. But in order to stay protected, it is just wise leadership for us. Bishop O also reminds us that Easter cannot be stopped or canceled. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Not yet. We still have to get through Holy Week. But we know the end. And that every day should be Easter Day, because we are Easter people, friends. Amen and amen. So here's my take two. I think God is calling us to be the church in new ways. We here at Ballatin UMC have been really great at extending the blanket of care, at being the hands and feet of Jesus in our world. You have shared your pastor. You have shared me, both in person and online with the world. And I know that although you have been relatively good about that, I know that sometimes it has been frustrating, because we are human after all. Here is the honest truth, okay? Some days, on days when I am feeling particularly extra tired or overextended, or perhaps even maybe just a tad bit disrespected, I feel that way too. Because shiny things cloud my vision. And by golly, I want a crown. I want my crown too. Where's mine, Lord? I have obediently followed you. So the disciples got caught up in the shiny things. James and John? They wanted a game of checkers. Remember back in Mark 9, 33 through 37? They wanted seats of honor next to Jesus. Crowns. Because, well, you know. Peter, yeah, he was the leader. He wanted a crown. As leader, he should have one. Mark 8, 27 through 38, and then 10, verse 28. Lord, I've given up everything to follow you. We've given up everything to follow you. I think God is calling us and using us to broaden his reach, even when it isn't always easy. Even in this time of not being inside our church building together, shiny things. Because shiny is comfortable, isn't it? I like shiny too. Jesus knows, Jesus sees, Jesus understands. He was betrayed with a kiss. Hershey kiss. By one of his own. His besties, his three besties, well, they fell asleep when he needed them to stay awake. His main man, Peter, who said he would never, did. Just as that stupid rooster crowed. The church, yeah, well, they certainly weren't. Father God, silent. My God, why have you abandoned me? Mark 15, 34. Shh. Be still. Just count. One, two, three. Heaven is at work behind the scenes in all of this. Just be patient and watch for the sunrise. We are saved because of all of this. Crowns. Everyone gets one now because he is risen. He is risen indeed. So hold steady, friends. Your crown, it's in those red letters. So let us pray. Lord Jesus, we confess to feeling anxious and scared because we are not used to all of this being still business. But that is what you call us to be, still before you. Putting you before the shiny things that we are ever so comfortable with. Forgive us for our disobedience and bring us back to you. God, our Creator and Redeemer. As we near Jerusalem with you this coming week, preparing for Palm Sunday, in our homes, may our shouts of Hosanna be ones of spiritual saving. As we center our hearts, our minds, our whole selves upon you, we give thanks for your saving grace through your Son, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You can find this sermon, of course, on Facebook, where you're tuning in now, probably, but we are also uploading it to our church website for those who do not have Facebook but have the internet access. And you can find that at www.ballatinumc.org. In the in-home worship packets that I delivered yesterday, they got the printed copy of this message. Just a reminder to the church is still functioning. The lights are still on. The internet is still on. And you are still paying my salary and health insurance for both Jim and I. And I can't tell you how appreciative that we are of that. And we know, especially during this difficult time, many are without work and they're trying to figure out what they're going to do. If you are able to send a donation, you can send a written check to the church address, which is found on our website, P.O. Box 383, Ballotin, Minnesota. There's also an online giving option. And so even if you are not a member of Ballotin UMC and you have appreciated these videos, you have appreciated my pastoral care, and you would like to give a donation of any size, thank you. Okay? Thank you for that. Continue to pray for one another. Sandy Jensen's mom died yesterday morning, Darlene DeGroat. And so we continue to pray over the entire DeGroat family as they say bye for now. And especially in this season of unsettledness and some restrictions on funerals. So they will make arrangements later for that. Just continue to pray for all with some health concerns and those that are missing loved ones that are in hospitals or senior care centers. I know you're finding ways to be with them, and so that is wonderful, but just keep that in mind. Continue to pray for our grocers, especially a shout out to the Scalehouse family, Bruce and Dawn, our Ballotin UMC sheepies, and all of their staff over at Tracy Food Pride. For their diligent work, especially during this time. Blessers up, here we go. Hey God, it's us kids. You're here, we're here. We thank you and we praise you for the ability to be together in this way. Keep us safe, keep us spirit-filled until we see each other again. In your name we pray, amen. Have a wonderful Sunday. Get out and get a walk in if you are able to, okay? Bye for now.